Council Church. Today we celebrate the third Sunday of Advent, and this morning here at Mother of Good Counsel we are also honoring Our Lady of Guadalupe. Our celebrant today is Father Taylor. If you are tuning into our Mass live stream, we have a song sheet available. If you are here at Mass, we continue to ask the congregation not to sing, but we always welcome clapping to the music. Let's all stand as we begin our celebration.
With a robe of salvation and wrapped me in a mantle of justice. be decked with her jewels. As the earth brings forth its plants, and a garden makes its growth spring up, so will the Lord God make justice and praise spring up before all nations. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. came for testimony, to testify to the light, so that all might have life through him. He was not the light, but came to testify to the light. And this is the testimony of John. When the Jews from Jerusalem sent priests and Levites to him to ask him, "Who are you?" he admitted and did not deny it, but admitted, "I am not Jesus Christ." So they asked him, "What are you then? Are you Elijah?" And he said, "No, I am not. Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." So they said to him, "Who then are you?" So we can give an answer to those who sent us. What do you have to stay and say for yourself? He said, "I am the voice of one who is crying in the desert, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as Isaiah the prophet did say." Some Pharisees were also sent, and they asked him, "Why then do you baptize if you are not Jesus Christ or Elijah the prophet?" John answered, "I baptize with water, but there is one among you whom you do not recognize, the one who is coming after me, whose sandal strap I am not worthy to untie." Now this happened in Bethany across the Jordan, where John was baptized. And this, my sisters and brothers, is the holy gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
First of all, can everybody hear me now?
Yes.
Now we have to keep our mask on while we talk mass. The only time we can have our mask is when we lift it to receive the body and blood of Jesus Christ. As you know, each and every one of us are challenged by the serious illness we have. And our Bishop David Zuli came up with some clarifications. Among them was, again, the wearing of masks, including the priest, including the lectors throughout, including the choir singers throughout the entirety of the mass. We also have to keep windows open. Even when it gets very cold, we must, as a health factor, keep a number of windows open, and if possible, a door to the outside. The restrictions are basically the same, 50%, up to 50%. But we also have to keep in mind that as we get ready for the Christmas season, we always have more people than normally come throughout the year, and still we have to be vigilant. We cannot pack any of our masses full of people, and no standing in the rear, in the back. Everyone has to have a seat and completely social distances. Again, that's for our own health and welfare. But you know, in all of that, we're blessed. So many denominations have been doing mass only on Zoom or online since the beginning of the pandemic. They have not returned to church yet. But we are blessed, we're still able to offer mass, but we realize that there's a risk involved. So we have to do everything we can to protect one another. You know, the beautiful thing about today, as I said earlier, is that we just, you know, lit the pink candle. Which stands and we think of rejoicing and being happy. And it's interesting, here we are right pretty close to the middle of Advent. And it's beautiful that we have that because of the readings today. One of the beautiful things about Isaiah the prophet is the author of that third point of Isaiah the prophet was very, very recognizing that he needed to be a prophet of hope. And as many others of the prophets, they were prophets of hope during a time when people were suffering, when they were in exile, when they had become slaves, and they longed for the day that the Lord would deliver them, forgive them, and bring them back. And the Lord did.
and do that.
And then there you're waiting John the Baptist, who we've been reading about in the last few weeks. Many call him the forerunner of Jesus Christ. But basically, he was not just making things ready for the Lord. Most important, he was questioning us, that you, me, we have to make our heart and life ready for the Lord. And a big part of that is acknowledging our sins and thinking about what are we doing in terms of what God is asking us to. I also thought that it'd be interesting. We celebrate two things too, you know, Feast of Our Lady of Guadalupe, and I'll have a little bit more to say about that. But the whole thing is that, isn't it interesting, we have this hopeful reading. When we are going through crisis after crisis, and our country has experienced sickness and death and illness from this pandemic in record numbers, more than just about any other country on the face of the earth. And we know, of course, that one helpful thing is the vaccine. But the vaccine, right away, is not going to be an instant answer. We have to be able, one, to receive it when it's available to us. And also remember that if we get the vaccine early, we still must adhere to wearing a mask, social distance, and sanitizing. Because it's going to be a great while before everyone gets that vaccine. But it is a joy of hope. Because we are able to see, as we've been said over the last few days, light at the end of the tunnel. And that we're able to see that trouble doesn't last always. But we have this challenge. And this challenge is just about like nothing else throughout the century. But it doesn't take away that God blessed us, that God wants to take care of us. But he wants very definitely for us to do our part. And that was a message in many ways for Isaiah the prophet. Because when he preached to the exiles, he also reminded them of what they had to do to make ready the way of God and how they would have to act once their exile was over and they would be back to what God had blessed them with all the times. And so it's interesting that these two guys are so very important as we have this third Sunday of Advent and we think of rejoicing and how good it is just to be able to know that God is with us. As we struggle then with the pandemic, as we struggle with the major divisions and anger and bitterness that's going on in our country, when you have crisis after crisis, it really can crush the spirit. But you and me know better. We know that people of faith as Catholics, we can rise above these things. We don't have necessarily the solution for them, but we can rise above and start the healing and forgiveness. And if we don't do that, then really we are part of the problem and not a part of the solutions. And so the Lord tells us, no matter who we are and where we are, what's going on in our life, don't just look at the downside in life. If you program yourself just to see what's happening on television, the news, the computer, 95% of it is about things going wrong. But we cannot let that rule our lives. What must rule our lives is the whole reality of putting our faith and trust in God. Part of it too is like reminding our brothers and sisters, you know, we've been hearing that a lot of people are afraid and won't take the vaccine. There's still large numbers of people who refuse to wear a mask, seriously endangering the lives of their families and others. We cannot be that kind. serious health things, I'm thinking the same thing. Take the vaccine. Again, no one can make anybody do it, just like it's hard to enforce the mask policy. But when we look at how we work through these things, remember, it's about a whole lot more than just you and me. It's about loving our neighbor as ourselves. And so we don't only want ourselves well, we want each other to be well. As we go rejoicing, which it is now, we also know, as John has told us, as Isaiah has told us, that there are times of trouble, but there are also times of healing and life getting better. So we should never, ever lose sight of that. Isaiah, from the beginning to the end, the prophet, well, the prophet of hope, when everything looked like doom and death. John the Baptist was a prophet of hope, even though he was challenged and ultimately was murdered because he was trying to make the way of the Lord. And then there's Jesus Christ, doing many of the same things that John the Baptist was. But at the same time, too, realizing that he at a very young age would suffer, be cruelly treated, and also be murdered. But that didn't take away the spirit of rejoicing. And so I hope and pray, my dear brothers and sisters, that as we attend Mass today, that we keep these kind of things in mind, that we remind ourselves that trouble doesn't last always. You know, there was an old African-American song that a lot of slaves sung during the time of slavery. And it was, "Nobody Knows the Trouble I've Seen." I'm sure some of us know that song. "Nobody Knows the Trouble I've Seen." One of the greatest singers that sung that was the late Mahalia Jackson. No one can sing it like her. But again, even in that song, "Nobody Knows the Trouble I've Seen," it's not just about the trouble itself. It was a song of encouragement. It was a song that said things seem to be as bad as they can be. But it won't always be like that. Yes, we are in a time of trouble. But it is also a time of rejoicing. A time of looking not just to the present, but to the future. And realizing that if we really want to have a good future, then we must start working for today. We can't sit on the sidelines and say, "I'm just going to relax until things get better." If all of us do that, things will not get better, and they will certainly get worse. And so that's the way we this year are preparing the way for the Lord. It is also a difficult time for all of this, because we know that so many of our beautiful Christmas traditions that we have been used to, in order to help others, we cannot do them this year. Like visiting family members, welcoming them into our home, going and singing Christmas carols at a group, going and gathering together for parties and celebrations. All of these things which are so much a part of a faithful Christmas time, we have to put them aside. But for those who complain, and especially for those who are unwilling to do it, don't you realize, why can't you make a little sacrifice so that you, your children, your family, and especially the older people in your families, parents, godparents, grandparents, great-grandparents, as much as we want to see them, we should not and must not have a big celebration. We can see light at the end of the tunnel, but we also have to realize that God helps those who help themselves. And that, in many, many ways, too, is what we celebrate today in terms of Our Lady of Guadalupe. And I would like to by a man who knows a whole lot about this feast day. His name is Simon Ruffin. He said, Our Lady of Guadalupe appeared in Mexico, and in 1531, he spoke to the indigenous language of the Aztec people, not the Spanish. And like Spanish language was a recent European import, had to be with Cortez, who conquered in 1521. The person that our Blessed Mother, she appeared to these folks, and she looked like them. Her skin was brown, as it was. She could speak in their language, and she could give them hope, even as life was so difficult. Our Lady of Guadalupe appeared to a man when he was 57 years old. And that beautiful vision that he had gave him inspiration and encouragement to help the people really believe that life could be better. Our Lady of Guadalupe, as she spoke and identified with these people in heritage and race and in language, she reminded them that trouble doesn't last all one day. Now, in the United States of America, here we are. And we have, in the hearts and minds of many, the same sinful colonial and cultural superiority that can be found in society at large, yes, and often even within our Catholic Church. It is perhaps ironic that today, it is the Spanish language, along with Latin American heritage, that is often seen, was often seen as inferior and worthless in the American Empire. So the message of Our Lady of Guadalupe is the same today as it was then. And we celebrate with these folks, and we remind ourselves that their struggle is our struggle because they still struggle today. Their hope is our hope. Their reconciliation is our reconciliation. We can't help but rejoice with this feast day of Our Lady of Guadalupe, because she just didn't appear in Mexico to Juan Diego. She also knew that he would spread the message of hope, of faith, and also forgiveness. And so the final message, do not be afraid to let her matches sing in deeply. Believe in it, love in it. And I do believe that on this third Sunday of Advent, Feast of Our Lady of Guadalupe, that this gives us hope, it gives us encouragement, and a desire like no other to not give in to hate, to discord, fear, to overburden word, but take it from Juan Diego and all the others who learned about this. Take it from my Virgin Mary, who appeared to them looking just like them. And take a look at ourselves, because this particular feast day is not just for those folks, but it's for all of us, because we have the same country, the same kind of difficulty, the same kind of racism, bigotry, which has been a part of our history, even up until today. And even with the pandemic, the people of Mexico had many plagues, just like we have today. But it didn't dampen their spirit, because they knew that not only would God change things for them, but he would make it possible for them to live in holiness and goodness. And so here at St. Mary Magdalene Church, we are so happy on this third Sunday of Advent to have this wonderful Mass in honor of Our Lady of Guadalupe. And we hope and pray that God will, through her intercession, bring about the healing that you and I need. And now let us pray our profession of faith. I believe.
Of our hearts, for the intentions on our prayer.
outside of church. Okay.
Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body,
which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. And once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples. Take this, all of you, and drink from it. It is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, so sins can be forgiven. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you've held us worthy to be in your presence and serve you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity. With Francis, our Pope, David, our Bishop, and all the people of God, remember our sisters and brothers who have fallen asleep in the hope of rising again, and all who died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that we marry the Mother of God with the blessed apostles, St. Mary Magdalene, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages. We may marry to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Through him, with and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Thank you.
Jesus, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. Happy are we who are called to his supper.
Lord, I'm not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be
Christmas. Also, let me put in a plug highly recommend this. If we're looking for something encouraging to read about our solidarity with one another and how we must share and live with other people, I urge you to get and take a copy of Pope Francis' book. We ask for a donation of $10 each for those who will take them. And then finally, keep in mind, as you know, we do have several, like on Christmas Eve, we're adding more masses on Christmas Eve and on Christmas Day. The purpose of this, of course, is that we are hoping and anticipating that not everybody will flock to one mass because we cannot go past the limit. And so please think about that as you decide what mass you're going to on Christmas Eve and Christmas Day. Now the Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.